Good morning and a very happy Christmas to you all, and a very warm welcome to our online service from the Parish Church of Wareham in Dorset. My name is Canon Simon Everett. I am the team rector for this parish, and today I am recording in the Priory Church of Lady St Mary. It is our hope that as you watch, you will feel drawn to participate in the worship, joining in the carols and the prayers, the words of which will be printed on the screen. And in doing so, we hope that you will meet with Jesus. After all, that is the aim of all our worship, to give glory and honour to God, Father, Son and Holy Spirit, and to be at one with his Son, Jesus Christ. So we pray that you will be greatly blessed by this service today. Our service opens now with a wonderful carol. We meet in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We now move into a time of confession. Christ, the light of the world, has come to dispel the darkness of our hearts. In his light, let us examine ourselves and confess our sins. The response after each petition is, forgive and heal us. Lord of grace and truth, we confess our unworthiness to stand in your presence as your children. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. The Virgin Mary accepted your call to be the mother of Jesus. Forgive our disobedience to your will. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. Your Son, our Saviour, was born in poverty in a manger. Forgive our greed and rejection of your ways. We have sinned. forgive and heal us. The shepherds left their flocks to go to Bethlehem. Forgive our self-interest and lack of vision. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. The wise men followed the star to find Jesus the King. Forgive our reluctance to seek you. We have sinned. Forgive and heal us. And Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now the collect or special prayer for today. Lord Jesus Christ, your birth at Bethlehem draws us to kneel in wonder at heaven touching earth. Accept our heartfelt praise as we worship you, our Saviour and our eternal God. Amen. Now we have our collect or special prayer for today. God in Trinity, eternal unity of perfect love, gather the nations to be one family and draw us into your holy life through the birth of Emmanuel, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We now have our Old Testament reading, and this will be followed by our second hymn of praise.
The reading today is taken from Isaiah chapter 61, beginning at verse 10, and going through to chapter 62 to verse 3. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness, just as a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the young plant come up, and a garden causes the seed to grow, so the sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. For Zion's sake I will not keep silent. For Jerusalem's sake I will not remain quiet, till her vindication shines out like the dawn, her salvation like a blazing torch. The nations will see your vindication, and all kings your glory. You will be called by a new name, that the mouth of the Lord will bestow. You will be a crown of splendour in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So, Lord, have mercy.
And we now have our gospel, which will be followed by today's sermon.
The gospel reading is from Luke chapter 2, beginning at verse 15. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to thee, O Christ.
Once upon a time, but not very long ago, and not so very far away from here, a young man at university became a Christian. While he was at university, he was surrounded by other people very like him who were also Christians. He went to a local church that was specifically geared around the many young people who came to be part of that community. He began to learn about God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and he began to learn to live his life in a different way. When his time at university came to an end, the young man moved away and headed out into the world of work and looked around for a Christian community of which to be a part. He found, near where he was living, a big church, a modern building, information about small groups and Bible studies and worship bands on the website. It sounded very like the church he had belonged to previously. And so, one Sunday morning, off he went. He arrived rather last minute. The service was just about to begin and the building was very crowded. As he walked in at the back of the church, people began to turn to look at him. A young man who had been a student until very recently and still looked like a student. People in this place were not used to ripped jeans, long colourful hair and piercings. The young man headed towards the front of the church, trying to spot a place where he could sit. This was obviously a very popular church, and try as he might, he could not find a single empty seat. This was not a problem to the young man. He headed down to the very front of the church and sat down on the floor. By now, everyone had gone very quiet and was waiting to see what might happen next. From another seat at the front of the church, an elderly man, who was one of the church elders, stood up. For a few moments, the only sound that anyone could hear was the shuffling footsteps and the tapping of the old man's stick. Everyone could see what was going to happen, and most of them had a great deal of sympathy with the old man. This was a most unusual occurrence in their church, and obviously it had to be addressed. Everyone watched. And then their watching and their assumptions turned to surprise as the old man lowered himself to the floor beside the young man and with a smile said, "Do you mind if I sit with you?" I don't know if this story is true, and it's not my story, but I really want it to be true. And part of the reason I want it to be true is because I think it has a lot in common with the story of the shepherds in the Christmas story. Shepherds did not always have a great reputation back in Jesus' time. They were at the bottom end of the social scale, despite the importance of sheep within their culture. A little bit of sheepy history here. Despite the way that, through the Old Testament, God is often talked about as a shepherd, in the traditional writing of the rabbis, being a shepherd was an unclean profession. In fact, in some places, there are lists of trades that should not be followed by a good Jew, and shepherds appear in many of those lists. Part of the problem seems to have been that flocks of sheep were privately owned, and yet they didn't always inhabit lands that were also privately owned. I guess there was a bit of argument over whose sheep was eating whose grass. So shepherds on the whole were something you didn't want to be. They were not particularly educated people, and as you will know, if you have ever worked with sheep, they were probably a bit smelly too. Other people looked at them in very much the way that the majority of people in that story about the student looked at him as he walked into their church. So, going back a little bit before this morning's reading, the shepherds were doing what shepherds do when first one angel and then a great host of them turn up to give them a message and an invitation. I suspect you will already have heard this more than once this Christmas, but here it is again. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." The shepherds would have known that their people had been waiting for the Messiah for a long time. But I wonder if they had made the same assumptions that a little while after them the wise men made. Did the shepherds also assume that this Messiah, being very important, would be born in a palace, or at least a very smart place? Is that why the angels added a sign for the shepherds when they said, "You will find the baby wrapped in cloths," the same way that you shepherds and your families wrap up your new babies, "and lying in a manger," a feeding trough, a place with which you shepherds are very familiar? Was that sign specifically to let the shepherds know that this was not an invitation to go to a palace or a place where they might be turned away as unclean and unwanted, but an invitation to go to the kind of place with which they, as peasant farmers, were very familiar? An invitation that says, "You are valued, you belong, you are welcome here." And was it that reassurance of familiarity that actually got the shepherds to a place of being able to say, "Come on then, let's go"? And they find the little family. I do wish there was a bit more detail about what that moment looked like. From the fact that after their encounter with the Holy Family, they go out and tell everybody about it, it was obviously pretty special. I like to imagine that they walked in and immediately knew that something really special had happened, and that they were a part of it. I like to think that they were filled with the joy and peace that a deep encounter with Jesus still brings today. I like to think that for the shepherds, it was a life-changing moment and nothing was ever quite the same again. Just like I like to think that the moment when that church elder sat down on the floor beside the student, that the peace and joy and challenge of Jesus the Messiah changed the lives of at least some of the people in that church forever. Mary treasures these things in her heart, and she is never quite the same again. Something has happened that will change the way that she lives the rest of her life. Christmas, the presence of God in our world, changing things for us forever. An invitation for everyone, absolutely everyone, to come into the presence of Jesus like the shepherds did. And then when they go out again, to keep that presence within us forever. Or at least until Jesus comes back and renews heaven and earth and we don't need to anymore. Before long, Christmas trees will be removed, decorations will come down, and this particular season will be over until next year. But what never fades is the life-changing presence of Jesus in our world. The question is, what do we do with our knowledge and experience of that life-changing presence? That is something we each have to work out for ourselves. But I just want to finish up by reading a poem by Howard Thurman. You may well know it. It turns up in a lot of places at this time of year. But it's a great reminder of the never-ending impact of Jesus coming to be a person like us. So this is The Work of Christmas by Howard Thurman. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flocks, then the work of Christmas begins, to find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the people, and to make music in the heart. My prayer is that God will help all of us to find where we fit within this. Amen.
Love incarnate, love divine, star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. No.
Now let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness.
As we worship in our homes today and reflect on the birth of the Christ child, let us pray trustfully to our Heavenly Father. We pray for all Christians celebrating with us all over the world. Let your gift to mankind in the sacred birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, be the focus of our living and of our giving. As we enter into this new year, let us be aware of the needs of others, the concerns of our planet, and to know that we can make the difference. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for peace and justice in the world, for all nations where there is war and conflict. We bring before you the people of Ukraine, Russia, Israel, Gaza, and Palestine. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon these nations and their leaders this festive time, and bring into their lives hope, reconciliation, and peace. We pray for all servicemen and women who serve in our forces, especially those who will not be joining their families at this time. Father, we ask that you guide Charles, our King, and that you direct all those in authority. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Christ, for whom there was no room in the inn, give courage to all who are homeless. For those who live in and on cardboard and newspapers, this festive season can be the loneliest time of year. Christ, who fled into Egypt, give comfort to all refugees. Christ, who fasted in the desert, give relief to all who are starving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In a moment of silence, let us offer our own thoughts and prayers for all workers and volunteers, especially our National Health and Emergency Services. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we commend to your healing all who are in pain or danger, all who are recovering from surgery, all who depend on others for life and movement. We pray that our prayers through you will give them hope and comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort, O Lord, we pray, all those who mourn the loss of loved ones. Give them faith and courage to look beyond the troubles that they feel at this present time, and to know that neither life nor death can separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we ask so much in prayer. Let us remember that all you ask from us is that we simply welcome you this new year and every year. Let us join together in the prayer our Father has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Before a prayer of blessing, we have our final hymn or carol. May God the Father keep you in all your days. May God the Son shield you in all your ways. May God the Spirit bring you healing and peace. And may God the Holy Trinity drive all darkness from you and pour upon you blessing and light. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and all whom you love this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. And a very happy Christmas to you all. God bless you at this time. Amen.